Now, I'm hoping that what we're doing today will be a little bit structured, like ACT treatment will be structured. So I would like to ask with, to start with informed consent. And very important thing that the client least then knows what you are putting through before you start. So we will typically talk about how ACT is different. And if you're familiar with traditional forms of CBT in a big way, the difference in ACT is that ACT doesn't try to stop or change your inner experiences. In a big way, we won't be working on thought stopping, changing, distracting from thoughts and so on. More so, we look at changing your relationship with the thought. Now, from the very start of treatment, an ACT is very kind of is focused on rather than Woody Allen type approach, 2-3 sessions a week for decades. It's, you know, what we try to do is brief treatment that establishes a platform for a person to then continue growing. We won't ever see the person when they're perfect. In fact, I'd be very concerned if any of my clients came back and said, I'm perfect. I've reached my full potential. Can you imagine how concerned you would be? Rather, we're kind of looking at creating a skill set after which they don't need us anymore. Part of informed consent is when we deal with pain, actually allowing it to be present in the world. This is part of why I asked Dawn to also include that this may be difficult. In terms of informed consent, I think part of what I would want to address here is when you probably, I don't know, do you work with doctors? Do you work alongside with hospitals' mainstream medical model? Your clients go to GPs? It's a very different, philosophically very different approach than ACT. So it is going to focus on what is your problem. Let us find a diagnosis, call it a name, identify what we're going to cut out, medicate, what we're going to change within you. Now ACT, instead of trying to change the symptom or deal with, identifying what's wrong with you, ACT doesn't do that. Instead, what we're trying to do is to find what is the purpose that you have for your life and what do we do best to help you get there. And then we address what things get in the way. So how do you work with a client who just comes back, I don't know, with a whole team of professionals who are trying to help him or her not have tinnitus? Through medication, through hearing aid, through noises that are added. And here we are talking about accepting the pain, and they've been working on not having the pain. Ouch. What do you do? So can I first invite you to recognize there's a conundrum. You're going to be facing some pain that is really kind of two very polar approaches, and you can absolutely have two very polar approaches as two different skills. Yes, it's very important that you give yourself a break from the symptom and go right ahead, and there is a whole team that will be working on helping you do that. And yes, long term you will benefit from learning to live with your tinnitus. And that's absolutely very important too. And that's another skill that I can help you build. You can work and interface with the outside world. It doesn't have to be working against you. I guess one very important thing I want to address is to summarize it in terms of informed consent. Three core scenarios that I hear from clients who have done ACT before and hate it now. So they fall into three categories. One, ACT doesn't care. I'm unheard, I say I'm suffering, and we say, so, what do you care about? Let's work on what you want to do with your life. Definitely not ACT. your suffering matters, your pain matters, absolutely. We are here to help people who suffer. Suffering plays a role. clients who feel pushed, and seriously, if I was recovering from, I don't know, water phobia and you pushed me into the water, I'd stop trusting you. This isn't right. No, we don't push people into doing. And this is a tricky one because we're in a caring profession. You want to see change in your client, and your client comes back and says, right back into the same thing you've taught the first session, as if they've taken nothing. They've done none of the things you asked them to do outside of the session. They're back in the same cycle and say, come on, man, give me something. And it becomes about you. It's pushing the client. Mm-hmm. And it becomes about you rather than the client. Mm-hmm. So no, that's definitely not act. It becomes enough stick to be the person with. And there's enough of our clients, they have enough sticks in the world. Blamed, if you can do anything, if you can build a life of purpose, and you haven't, then it's your fault. Definitely not part of ACT. If you could do it, you would do it. If you didn't do it, you couldn't do it. It's just that simple. I guess an antidote to those, I find, is we approach people with compassion. Pain matters. I don't want to be in pain, just like anybody else doesn't want to be in pain. And I think I grew up in an era where, and maybe for boys more so than for girls, are you bleeding? No, you get it. It's kind of a sense of ignoring pain. And I think part of compassion is to notice, yes, there is suffering. It matters. It's not crazy. Just because I'm hurting doesn't mean there's something wrong with me. If we've been on this planet long enough, we suffered. We've suffered in ways we didn't think we would. I think if we've been on this planet long enough, we've been surprised as just to how we could suffer. And one of the unkind things that, well, at least when I was growing up, was to try to change it, tickle you, tell you about, well, you should be lucky that you had this relationship, not sad because you lost it. Or the kids in Africa, starving kids in Africa, I don't know why that was always the end of it. Hey, you should, you know, feel lucky. We don't have to fix it. Suffering doesn't have to be fixed, and sometimes trying to fix it is an unkind thing to do. So I would like us to kind of level up here and for each of you to do an exercise from which it will be kind of a foundation for anything that we do today will be from this respectful, compassionate, curiosity perspective. I would like to ask everyone to have a piece of paper and make a symbol on that piece of paper. Please don't write. I don't have a shredder here. So make a symbol that indicates something private you wouldn't share with the world. Maybe a memory you have from your past, maybe a fantasy you have, something that you would not want to share. If you need a piece of paper, ask. We have some notepads here. You have a piece of paper? Everyone has a piece of paper? Anyone need a pen? Symbolize, to kind of indicate that on the piece of paper, that memory, that private thing that you don't want to share with others. Turn to another person here, and I invite you with this note crumpled in your hand, look at another person and consider parting from this piece of paper and someone taking control over something that's quite personal for you. And I would like you to take turns then opening that hand and just get a sense of how humble, respectful, caring would the other person have to be for you to feel safe to then part from that memory, fantasy, from that kind of backseat thing that you have around yourself you wouldn't want the world to know. take a moment to experience that for the present. Thank you.